Jan, we'll talk a little bit about your relationship with political scientists and prominent political scientists such as Crawford Young and Michael Shazberg, who were working in Madison, but on top of it were working on the Democratic Republic of the Congo, sure, your own field. So I'm curious to know, you know, what happened when Crawford Young arrived? Was he there before you arrived? What were your kind of collaboration and conversation with political scientists here?
Well, when Crawford Young arrived, first he was interviewed in the house next to this one.
Oh, really? So,
for the and job. We were living here at the time. So,
who was living there then?
The dean of letters and science was there, but he was in political science too. In any case, we were immediately on the same level of interest for two reasons. One, of course, was that we both had worked or were interested in the Congo. And the second one was Crawford Young's book was being published or had been published, I've forgotten what. And it was one on which practically everybody could agree as to the framework. It was a real tour de force. You know, to impose a clear framework onto the history of the Belgian Congo that went in every whichever direction. Nobody had really, you know, worked at this seriously. So he put an overall hypothesis which allowed to sort out the various issues and put them in relationship to one another. You know, and begin to give answers from the literature. Essentially, the whole of Crawford Young was based on the literature. And so we agreed on the importance of that work. We did not agree, essentially, on whether there really had been a trinity of church and business and politics. It looked like
it. Or the state.
Yeah, and the state. That these three things went together. It looked like it, but again, for Crawford, this was, I wouldn't say automatic, but it was axiomatic. You would accept that unless the contrary was proven, let's say. Now,
just verify that you are bien zoomed in the. Yes.
So, Crawford, Crawford and I got along. And we got enough along so that we organized some joint seminars. Because many of his students were in my seminars and many of my students were in his seminars.
But you were not teaching them together?
Yes, we did teach them together. Okay. We did this twice or three times. It's difficult in Madison because of practical reasons.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
But in any case, it was interesting because Crawford was first very good at making sure that students did read the bibliography and that they understood on precise points what had been the first opinion, then the revision, and the revision of the revision, that they understood that historiography very well. And he was a master in getting to the essentials of that literature. He still is. So, on the other hand, whenever, let's say, the theoretical book went overboard, then it was my job to see that the concrete cases were brought up. You see, you don't object to a theory. You bring up a concrete case that seems to be a cross, and you have to try to explain that. So we had...
With students, you were...
Oh, yes, the students were there.
Right.
And it was very useful on everybody's side.
I
learned a great deal, and so did the students. By the way, I also learned that Crawford Young, at that time, was not very well liked in political science because he was not theoretical enough. I mean, political science, if you can refer to Aristotle or Plato, please do. It gives you that, and that aspect was not there. I mean, he was pragmatic as well. Well, of course, Michael Shazberg was his student. And Michael Shazberg absorbed all of this, but he absorbed also a whole anthropological angle.
Yeah, he was very anthropological,
yes.
Michael.
And which he got from the anthropology teaching he had, which was at that time was primarily still my own, and Aidan Sawdall's. So Aidan Sawdall was very important for Michael. And he worked as an assistant to Sawdall for a while as a graduate student. And so, you know, it's hard to say whether, you know, who precisely was responsible, but Michael came on with a very strong idea about anthropology. And he got it a little bit before he went to the Congo, but when he did his field work, when he came back, he was absolutely convinced. And, you know, maybe it was the politics of beer, as he maintained, that did it in Lisala, or, you know, the way how you voted at the time. But in any case, what Michael started to try to do was to start an alternative political science, one where you do not take the concepts that are in general use, like president or political party, you know, or state, but look at local circumstances and bring up what really matters and how the ideology is translated in local terms. Mm-hmm. Now, he did this again.
Or created.
He did this again very creatively, but it may be one reason why he didn't rise to the top of the profession, which he didn't, I think. But basically, because it goes against the fundamental tenets of political science in general, you know.
But it was providing a fantastic training to students and a great analysis of the...
And also he provided students with a lot of critical thinking.
He's theoretical in this sense. He makes the students read wide and large. And they have to know really what's going on.
So he got along very well.
I did not
have to go along with anybody else in political science. Right. So, you know.
Did you, Crawford and yourself, exchange your manuscript? Did you have...
No.
Never, you didn't, never had Crawford read your manuscript or the other way around?
No, we never did that.
Ah.
You know, so we always waited for each other's manuscripts.
I see.
Because it's hard to say what would happen.
But didn't you organize the African Studies program with Crawford and Philip Curtin?
I organized the African Studies program with Philip Curtin. And then, you know, it was in place by the time Crawford arrived. Now, you know, when it came to what the input of different departments, then of course, Crawford was invaluable. Crawford, at the time he arrived, was not the Crawford you know. He was not a person who was supremely competent in administrative matters yet. Later on, of course, he would become practically, you know, president of the Senate of the university, this and that. He became a very accomplished administrative politician, you might say, as well. But in the beginning, he was not. He was always wise, you know, his advice was always good. But he kept...
So he did not really participate in organizing the African Studies Forum institutionally so much at the beginning, at least.
No, he didn't. Let's put it this way. He was, for instance, not convinced that you needed to learn African languages as a political scientist if you went to Africa. But as a practical person, he was convinced that if you could get a grant, a Title VI grant, then you better start learning an African language at the same time. Because that's
pragmatic.
Two good things together, you know. So that negotiating for Title VI programs was something he was not involved in. This was, at the time, I think, primarily Phil Curtin's thing. Because Title VI was for the whole university, all the area programs together. So, he was not that involved in it. But he did point, you know, to the sort of shibboleths that you have in every discipline. You can do this, you can propose that, but there are certain basic things you cannot do. You cannot change this habit in political science or in history or in anthropology. And for that, you know, his input was very good on that. Later on, he's never sort of had that much interest in the program as such. You know, he came to many meetings, to most meetings.
Right, he was not.
He was a good citizen, as they say, but he did not propose much. On the other hand, much less, for instance, than Schatzberg.
Mm-hmm.
Schatzberg has been much more involved with this program than Crawford has been. But that's personalities. It's not because they're political scientists.
Yeah, of course, yes. Great.
Okay.
Thank you, Jan.
All right. That's it.